You're listening to the WON Radio Network. The following is a WON Jimbo Fail Exchange radio production.
Countdown for blast off. X minus 5, 4, 3, 2, X minus 1. Fire.
If you're looking for action-packed classic fun, look no further.
Carter, there's a machine gun. Look out, Danny!
Up in the sky, look!
It's a bird!
It's a plane! It's Superman!
Are you Superman?
For the best in old-time radio adventures, you've come to the right place. This is one nostalgic weekend.
A cloud of dust and a hearty, Hi-Yo Silver, the Lone Ranger. Under Geronimo refused to live up to their treaties in the early days of the Western United States, the uprisings of the other tribes were usually caused by misunderstandings, and there was no one who realized this better than the masked rider of the plains. He fought for peace with all the daring and resourcefulness at his command. It was he, more than any other man, who created a bond of friendship between the Indians and the white settlers, and finally made possible the winning of the West. Return with us now to those thrilling days of yesteryear. From out of the past come the thundering hoofbeats of the great horse Silver. The Lone Ranger rides again.
Come on, Silver! We're heading for Rim Rock Hills! Tonto's waiting for us! Hail, Silver, away!
Old Potluck Sims raced into the little town of Calaveras and reined up in front of the cafe. The Lone Ranger, without his mask but wearing a disguise, watched him leap from the saddle and run up the steps.
Out of my way, stranger. Barkeep.
Hello, Potluck.
What's wrong?
Plenty, stranger. Barkeep, pour a drink for the unluckiest man in Calaveras County.
What's the trouble now?
Hurry up.
Oh, here.
Go look and see. Are they coming up the street yet?
Who?
The Kiowas.
Kiowas? What'd they be doing in town?
They're after my scalp.
You must be wrong. The Kiowas aren't on the warpath. I passed their camp today.
So did I. That's the trouble. Give me another drink. Look at that hand. It's shaking so I can't even hold the glass.
Well, let's have it. Tell us what happened.
I took a shortcut.
Huh?
Coming over Rimrock Hill, instead of following the trail, I headed Dusty down the bank. 'Twasn't the first time I'd done it. Nothing ever happened before. But the shale broke under us. We was in the middle of a landslide quicker than you can wink an eye.
Yeah, what's a landslide got to do with engines?
I'm coming to that. Dusty kept his feet, and when we hit the ledge where the trail circles around, we was all right.
Well, we know you didn't go over the cliff, or you wouldn't be here.
We didn't go over, but the landslide did.
Couldn't have been much of one.
Oh, it kept building. There was a big rock straight in its path, and it tore the rock loose.
Well, I still can't see what you're so excited about.
I can. The Kiowa camp was at the foot of that cliff.
Yeah, and the chief's wigwam was right in line with the landslide. That big rock crashed down on it and smashed it to the ground. There was the most awful screaming and yelling you ever heard in your life. It sounded like a kid. Some of the braves could see me up on the cliff, and they shook their fists at me. So I dug my spurs into Dusty and hightailed for town.
Yeah, that's bad. You recollect what happened to this here town the last time them Kiowas put on their war bonnets?
They burned it down.
And what started the trouble here before?
The chief's brother was shot for a rustler.
Was he guilty?
No, it was a mistake. It was an accident just like this.
There's no arguing with them Kiowas when they're riled. I'm going to take a look up the street.
Yeah, me too.
I'm the unluckiest man in Calaveras County.
Yeah, no sign of him yet.
Who are you looking for?
Kiowas.
Injuns?
I started a landslide on Rimrock Hill, Doc, and a big rock landed on the chief's wigwam.
I'd like to know if anyone were injured.
I don't know for sure, but I told you there was plenty of yelling and jumping around.
Yeah, doggone. Just as likely as not, you got them Kiowas down in the whole town.
I might be able to do something.
What?
Well, I'm a doctor, and if anyone was hurt, I might be able to fix them up. Sort of make up for what Potluck did.
Yeah.
It's a good thought, but I wouldn't advise it.
No?
Not until we know exactly what's happening and how the Indians are taking it. You might be risking your life.
Well, I sure hate to see trouble if anything can be done to stop it.
Hey, look out the window. Smoke signals.
Signals? Let me see.
They're right enough.
Tonto.
What's that you said, stranger?
I'll have to ride on.
Potluck, those are engine signals.
You think so?
And if you start a trouble, if them smokes got anything to do with you busting up that Kiowa wigwam, then you ought to be run out of town.
Doggone, it wasn't my fault. I told you how it happened.
You should have been more careful. You should have stuck to the trail.
If I could only explain to the chief that it was an accident.
Yeah, you heard what the stranger said, and he's right. That Kiowa camp isn't safe for white men until we find out if anyone was hurt.
And if there was, you're
then
gonna...
this town won't be safe neither.
And if they saw me up there, I'm the first one they'll go after. Did I say Calaveras County? I'm the unluckiest man in the whole United States.
The Lone Ranger knew that the smoke signals did not come from the Kiowas, but from Tonto. He raced Silver out of town and toward the distant hill, where the smoke rose in twin pillars. At last, he reined up beside the waiting Indian.
And what is it, Tonto? And why did you call me?
They're plenty trouble.
The Kiowas?
How you know?
Let's see, their camp's over there.
That's right.
And what have they been doing?
Tonto hear drum, hear war cry. Tonto ride that way.
To the camp?
Ride near camp, not in camp.
But the Kiowas looked as if something were up, is that it?
I'm plenty mad.
Call scout, Tonto.
Here, scout. He put out fire.
I'll help you. The underbrush is dry and we can't take any chances. And we've got to hurry.
Not good. Where we ride?
To the Kiowa camp. Potluck Sims started a landslide by accident. And the rock tumbled down onto the chief's wigwam. We're going to find out if anyone was injured.
Maybe so.
And then we'll have to find out if they saw Potluck and if they plan to get revenge. Come on, Silver.
Get him up, scout.
Hail, Silver, away!
The Lone Ranger and Tonto raced across the unbroken prairie toward the wild Rimrock Hills where the Kiowas had made their camp. Once the hills were reached, they headed upward. Finally arrived at the ledge where Potluck had watched the landslide.
There, Kiowas.
They mean business, all right. I'm going to get this disguise off and put on my mask. Now give me that cloth you have in your saddlebag.
Here, cloth.
Thanks.
Now what do?
One moment. I get the rest of this stain off my face. There, now my mask.
Here, mask.
Tonto, we're riding to that camp below. I wonder if there's a trail from above here leading directly down. What's that over there?
Well, maybe that trail.
And we'll have a look. Come on, Silver.
Come up, scout.
Well, this is a way down, all right, Tonto. Steady, Silver.
Oh, scout. Plenty steep.
The horses can make it. Now, listen, Tonto. These Indians are strangers to both of us. The fact that you're an Indian may lead them to accept you. If you seem to come as my friend, however, you'll be mistrusted. So you're going to take my guns and hold one of them on me. Now, I'll ride down this path first. You'll follow as though I'm your prisoner.
Tonto not want to do that.
It's best for both of us, Kemosabe. I'll be your prisoner, understand? If they don't want to let me leave their camp again, you can see to it that I escape.
Yeah, Tonto savvy. You take big risks, though.
We have no choice. Here, take these guns. And keep me covered with one every moment.
Yeah, we got them.
All right, Silver. Down the path, old fellow. Come on.
Get him up, Scout.
Easy does it, old fellow. Careful. Careful. You stumble, Silver. They both be killed. Almost there, old boy.
Good work.
Explain, I'm your prisoner, Tonto.
Lometa, Carone, Apato, Manicte.
Steady, Silver.
Oh, Scout.
And what did he say, Tonto?
Him ask Tonto name. Ask why bring prisoner.
Tell him you heard there'd been trouble. On the way here, you met me and brought me along.
Nanu Tonto, Kemosabe. Lepo Lampe, Kurobat, Roronanko Kalupa.
Naktu Suorame, Tabamukita, Kelat, Papus Tebiti, Madamanikte.
That's a child crying, Tonto. Crying as though it were in pain.
Rock hurt chief's Papus. Papus, plenty bad hurt.
I've got to see that child, Tonto. Tell the chief you want to look at the injury. I'll be able to go along as your captain.
Tonto Nego, Rape.
Rape.
It's all right. Papus in tipi there. You go, Tonto Palo.
You're doing fine, Tonto. Come on. This is the tent.
You go in. That wife of chief, mother of Papus.
Tell her I'll not harm the child, but I must look at it.
Manikte lepo, ramekalu, no pali.
No pali.
You look.
Oh, no.
The leg must be broken, Kemosabe. I'll have to examine it closer. There. It's all right. I'll not hurt you. Now hold still.
And what you see?
The leg is broken in several places.
And bad.
These Indians can probably set a simple break easily enough. But I don't believe they have the skill to take care of this. I wonder if... What's that?
We look.
It's potluck.
Doggone, I wish I could make you understand. Ain't there any of you that can speak English? It was all an accident. I started this life, but I couldn't help it.
Look up!
Come on, Tonto.
You're the chief, aren't you? Well, I'm just a poor old broken hard luck guy that never meant to... Hey, a masked man.
You're in a bad fix, potluck.
You don't have to tell me that. Can you tell the chief...
He won't listen to you now. That rock hit his baby son and broke his leg.
Gosh.
His only son.
But it wasn't my fault. Can't you help me out?
He's determined to punish someone for the accident.
Then I guess it's got to be me. That's better than having them burn the town.
We'll try to help you out.
Honest?
We'll do our best, both for your sake and for the other settlers. If you were punished, they'd try to get revenge. The Indians would fight back, and the war might spread to the whole frontier.
You've got plan?
Tell the chief the landslide was an accident.
Time to tell him.
Oh, wait. Tell him this also. Say Potluck is sorry for the injury to the chief's child and will heal him. Do you understand? Potluck will promise to remedy the harm he's done.
Hey, you're just getting me in worse all the time. I don't know nothing about fixing a broken leg. If you say I can and I don't, they'll have my scalp for sure.
If it works, the child will be helped. And you may get out of this alive.
All right, Tonto.
Repeat what I've told you to the chief.
Tonto, do it. Lope.
Tonto, Gepu.
Ralu, Dunika, Manik, Tehopa. Palke honen romale tokale. Nebach wohanen kano.
Ludo pilfish, madapapus kalut. Rako tene no lubeko.
Well?
Him say paleface fix papus, paleface live. Him not do it, paleface die.
At least we've got a chance, Tonto. Now listen to me closely. I'm going to make a break for it. These Indians have laid down their bows and arrows. I can get to Silver and get away before they can shoot. You fire over my head as though you're trying to bring me down. We can't let them suspect you're helping me. Now, most Indians are bad shots. so they won't be surprised when you miss.
Not right.
After I'm gone, tell the chief that Potluck must be alone in the wigwam with his son to do the child any good. Everyone must leave the tent, even the child's mother.
Me tell him.
If Potluck isn't left alone, my plan will fail. I'm going to make a break for it now, Kemosabe.
You go.
Here, Silver. Let's go, old fellow.
The curtain falls on the first act of our Lone Ranger story. Before the next exciting scenes, please permit us to pause for just a few moments.
Let's join Dan McCullough and his pal, Eddie.
Say, Dan, I've got an idea.
Yeah?
You remember the old game where I think of something and then you ask me questions and guess what it is?
Sure, Eddie. Why?
Well, let's play that game. Only let's make it about those insignia and warplane buttons I'm collecting. The ones from packages of Kellogg's Pep.
Okay. You want to start?
All right. I'm thinking of something that's red and blue and yellow and black and white.
Oh, that's one of those insignia buttons, all right, with all those colors. Let's see. Is it a picture of a bird?
Nope.
A bomb?
No.
An animal?
Well, yeah, an animal.
Well, that gives me something to start on. Now, is it one of the second series of buttons?
Right.
Let's see, an animal. Is it a bear?
Nope.
Hey, this is getting tough. A dog?
Guess again.
I know. A tiger.
Oh, you guessed it. But I'll bet you can't tell me which squadron that insignia belongs to.
Oh, that's easy, Eddie. It's Marine Fighter Squadron VMF 224. And like the other buttons in this swell second series, it's a honey. Clear, brilliant colors, sharp outlines. Why, you can even see the tough expression in the tiger's eyes. And the rings around his tail. He's all dressed up, too, with a cap and a sweat jersey and boxing gloves. Yes, sir, these insignia buttons are just about the classiest looking things you ever saw. And they're so easy to get. You don't send in any money, not even a box stop. And you can't buy them anywhere. You just make sure Mother gets you a package of that super delicious whole wheat flake cereal, Kellogg's Pep. Then, inside you'll find a prize, an exciting insignia or warplane button. There's a button in every package, and it's a prize for you from P.E.P. Pep, made by Kellogg's of Battle Creek. Next time it's too rainy for you to be out of doors, here's an idea for what to do. Get out your collection of insignia and warplane buttons from packages of Kellogg's Pep and see how close you are to having all the buttons in both the first and the second series. Why, you'll probably make up your mind to eat more of that super delicious whole wheat flake cereal so you can get more prizes. Then you might see how many of those insignia you can identify, like Marine Bombing Squadron 433, for example. You can remember that with a red dragon with two tails riding a bomb and firing a machine gun. By the time you get through, you'll be mighty proud of your collection, believe me. Because, you see, these buttons really are smart-looking. The colors are clear and bright and sharp, really stand out against the sparkling white background. And they're made of metal, so they'll last indefinitely. Now, if anyone should ask you how you got those swell buttons, tell them it's easy. You don't send in a single penny. No, sir, not even a box stop. And you don't buy them. You just ask Mom to get a package or two of Kellogg's Pep. Then, look inside for your exciting prize, a brilliant insignia or warplane button. There's a button in every package of P.E.P. Pep, made by Kellogg's of Battle Creek.
Now to continue our story. The Lone Ranger, urging Silver to his greatest speed, made his escape from the Kiowa camp. In the meantime, Potluck Sims' wife returned home from a visit to a neighbor, found her husband gone, and an arrow sticking in the wall. She ran to the cafe and...
Indians! They got Potluck! Help! They got Potluck!
What's that, man? You said Indians got your husband?
I just got home. He was gone. Gone.
How'd you know it was Redskins took him?
An arrow in the wall. There were feathers full of them dropped. Kiowa feathers.
So them Indians did see Potluck on that cliff.
They did, sure enough.
See him? What did he do?
Ma'am, I'm sorry. But Potluck was in here telling us about starting a landslide that rolled down on the Indian camp.
Oh,
most likely killed some of them.
Then they'll do away with Potluck.
He's one of us. We can't let them Redskins get away with this if we can stop it.
You've got to get him back. You've got to.
We'll do the best we can, ma'am.
The only thing to be done is to load up our guns and ride after him. He said there was camp west of here in the Rimrocks, didn't he?
Which means there must be somewhere along Whitewater Creek. That's the only fifth water there is. And they can't make camp where there ain't no water.
Oh, hurry. Potluck, he's killed.
Fellas, this here cafe is closed for business right now. All of you get your horses and come on. We're riding.
All right.
I'll go.
You stay right here, Mom. We'll handle this. Come on, fellas.
Save him.
We'll do all that can be done, ma'am.
Get in the saddle. Everybody got shooting irons?
Yeah.
Then come on.
Get up there. Out the west trail, folks. Come on.
Get up. Doggone potluck anyhow. For getting things in this kind of a mess.
I'll bet plenty that if he gets clear of this, he won't be in such a hurry again.
If he gets clear.
Get up. Get all there.
Get up. Get out
there. Hey, who's that coming?
Why, it's a masked fella. And coming from the same way we're riding.
Come on, old boy. Rein up. Hold on there.
Oh.
A crook.
Go, Silver. Oh, boy.
Put up your hand.
I'm not on.
Then what
but
are you...
But you've got to listen to me. Potluck Sims is being held captive by the Kiowas to the west.
We know it. That's where we're heading. We just now found it out.
And we're going to clean out that camp and bring Potluck back with us. If he's still living.
Wait.
Give the masked fella and lend him a gun, will you, Bob?
I said wait. You
now
can't
you...
help him by attacking. It's a large camp. Those Kiowas outnumber you.
But it's guns against bow and arrows.
Even if you did defeat them, they take care of Potluck first. Stay away from the camp. I have another plan.
You mean a way to get Potluck free?
Yes, you men might save him. Doing it your way, you'd arouse every Indian in the country. To save the life of one man, 100 others might be killed.
Even so, we
My
might...
plan would avoid that. Might even make the Indians your friends.
Well, listen. What you got in mind?
Where's the doctor?
To home, I reckon.
And we'll get him. And he and I'll return to the Kiowa camp alone.
But alone? You must be loco.
Or maybe this is some trick. Maybe the masked fella's in with the Redskins.
I'm not.
Maybe so. But anything you've got planned, we'll go along to make sure it ain't a trick.
And spoil everything.
If it wasn't a trick, you wouldn't be so doggone anxious to keep us out of it.
Everything depends on approaching that camp without being seen or heard. And what chance would you men have to get close without being detected?
Just the same, you can't...
If you don't trust me, one of you can go along. No more than one, however.
I don't know,
Bob. You can see I'm not armed. The man that comes along can shoot me easily if he sees I'm trying to trick him.
I'll go along. And if you're up to some crooked stunt, I will shoot. And don't you forget it.
Then come along.
Where to?
First to the doctor's home.
Get up. It don't look like there's anything left for us to do, fellas, but head back for town or sell.
That's right.
Well, then, come on. Get up there. Come on. Get up.
The Lone Ranger and his companion race to the home of old Doc Evans.
Steady, Silver, steady.
Oh, boy, whoa there, whoa.
Find Doc's horse. Get it saddled. I'll go in and get him.
It won't take me a minute.
What's this?
Doctor, Potluck Sims is a prisoner of the Kiowas west of town.
No.
You can save his life.
Me? But what can
you
I...
You said today that you'd be willing to attend those Indians if you knew that any'd been injured.
How would you know that?
Never mind that. Did you mean what you said?
Of course I did.
Then get your case, your instruments at once. You're going to set the leg of a child.
The young one of one of them Redskins?
The son of the chief. Now hurry.
My case is right over here.
I got the doc's horse.
Good. We'll be right there. Are you ready?
Lead the way.
Your horse is saddled.
Fine. That you, Bill?
Sure is, Doc. I'm going along.
Let's hope we're in time.
To the saddle.
Go ahead.
Come on, Sylvie. Come on.
It was early evening when the Lone Ranger and his two companions set out again for the Rimrock Hills. On the way, the shadows deepened to night, and in the camp of the Kiowas, fires had been built. Tonto, using all his persuasion, had seen that the instructions of the masked man were carried out. The injured child was left alone in the teepee with Potluck and...
Doggone it, young'un. Can't you keep still for just a little? You're going to have my scalp with all that hollering. Doggone if you ain't. Gosh, kid. I never knew anybody could be as cute as you are. Old Potluck didn't mean to hurt you. Honest, he didn't. Gee, I'd rather it was me laying there than you. Yes, sir, young'un. That's just what I wish. Gosh, listen to him. Them varmints want results and they ain't getting them. They ain't gonna have patience much longer. Wonder where the masked feller went. What he had in mind?
Potluck.
Oh, it's you, Tonto. Where you been? Talking to them Redskins?
Them not wake longer.
They ain't?
Them say you not help Papoose. You get killed.
Now they can't do that. They...
Me try make him wake. Them not do it.
Did they send you after me, Tonto?
But
the masked feller, he had some scheme. Said he had anyhow.
Oh, him got plan. Maybe him too late, though.
Too late?
You come.
I got you? Well, I might just as well face it now as later, I reckon. Go on, Tonto. I'll follow. Poor young'un here. I sure do wish I could have done something to ease him.
You come.
Yeah. Look at him. I'm scared. I can't help it.
Me try and make him wait a while longer. Then maybe friend get here.
Do your best, Tonto.
Lay to car, no lat.
Okay.
Manik te rulo, soke noge.
Put me to board.
Will he listen to you, Tonto?
Him heap man. Him not want wait. Say you plenty bluff. Not help, Papoose.
Gosh, I never said I could. That was the mask feller's doing. It was him that said I could help the young'un, not me.
That not matter now.
I guess it don't.
Tolo, Papoose, Palefish. Malatoke. Lomodo.
What did he say that time, Tonto?
Him say brave, hear Papoose cry. Tell him listen. Papoose still feel bad. Papoose feel bad. You die.
Oh. Okay.
Poor kid.
Him hurt plenty bad.
Need to look for it. Okay.
But Tonto. Tonto. The kid ain't crying no more.
Tuma. Luke.
Injun, go to teepee. Find out what's wrong.
Come along, Tonto. We might just as well see the worst for ourselves. They're crowding inside the tent so fast, maybe there won't be room for us. Come on. Let's push our way in.
Illa.
You look.
What? Tonto. The kid's just laying there grinning. What's happened? What?
Look. Leg.
A splint. Somebody's been here and fixed up that young'un's leg. I don't savvy this. Gosh, it wasn't fixed up like that when I left just now.
Chief think you do it. Him happy.
Oh.
Lipe sulama nikte roro. Paleface naga papoose hope.
I don't know what you said, Chief, but I sure hope it was something friendly.
Well, him say you heap good medicine man. Papoose not cry, and you good paleface.
He honestly thinks it was me that fixed his young'un? He ain't mad at me no more?
That's right.
You think he'll let me leave here? Yippee. I don't know what happened, nor how, nor who done it. But Tonto, from now on, if I ever catch anybody doing anything mean to the Redskins, I'll push down a landslide on them on purpose.
Potluck rode away from the Kiowa camp, his ears ringing with the sincere thanks of the Indians, but still bewildered by his last-minute escape from death. Tonto rode beside him, and...
And Tonto, you really think the masked fellow had a hand in this? But how? What could he have done? It seems like magic to me.
Me not know, but him do it all right.
Hello.
There, friend. Ho's got ho.
Whoa, whoa, boy.
Come on, Silver. Steady, Silver.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Bill, Doc Evans,
what... So they let you go, Potluck.
Still think you're unlucky?
But you fellas, here with a masked man, I don't savvy.
Potluck, you owe your release and your life to the doctor.
Huh?
It was he who set that child's leg.
He did?
At the risk of his own life. Those Indians wouldn't have let you go. They suspected anyone, but you helped the boy.
Doc, I don't know what to say. How to thank you?
Don't thank me.
But then...
The masked man gives me the credit, but he's the one that really did all this.
Yeah?
It was him who kept the men from town attacking and starting more trouble than they already had been.
Gosh, if he hadn't stopped us, I'd hate to think of the ruckus that'd be around here for the next few months.
The masked man brought me here and led me to the wigwam and got me safely inside.
But how did you get in there? I never seen nobody go in.
We approached the wigwam from the back. Entered by lifting up the side and crawling under.
Now, listen here, stranger.
Yes?
I don't know just how to say it. I ain't much for words and such. But seeing that young un suffering, such a cute little nipper, too, and knowing it was on account of me that he was hurting so, well, it done something to me I ain't forgetting.
What do you mean?
And as for Injuns not feeling things the same as us folks, I learned different about that, too. The chief, he couldn't have worried more about that poor Titan if he'd have been one of us. And like I told Tonto back there in the camp, the fellow that makes trouble with them Kiowas, deliberate, is going to have me to deal with.
Misunderstanding's always been at the bottom of the trouble with the Kiowas. Tell your story wherever you can, Potluck, and there'll never be another Indian uprising in the district.
Just leave it to me, Mask Man.
Come on, Tonto.
Get him up, Scout.
Hi-oh, Silver, away!
There's more classic fun coming away right here on One Nostalgic Weekend. But first, this.
Hi, this is Jonathan Rios. If you're looking for action-packed classic fun, look no further than One Nostalgic Weekend.
Up in the sky, look!
It's a bird!
It's a plane! It's Superman!
I am Superman!
So fasten your seatbelts every week for a trip back into time, only on One Nostalgic Weekend. This is One Nostalgic Weekend on the WON Radio Network.
And here's a word from RCA Victor. Last week, the curtain went up on the 75th anniversary of the National Baseball League and the 50th anniversary of the American League. There's no better way to celebrate than by enjoying at first hand the thrills and the clean sportsmanship of baseball today. Baseball today, it's the American way. Of course, the next best thing to a seat in the stands is a seat in front of a 19-inch RCA Victor television. RCA Victor's new extra-powerful picture pickup gives you the best possible reception everywhere. You know RCA Victor television is most in demand, but here's really important news. RCA Victor 19-inch television is available. It's on display now at dealer stores. So insist on the best. Insist on seeing 19-inch million-proof television by RCA Victor. When you do, you'll agree, inch for inch, your best buy in television is RCA Victor 19-inch.
And now, back to One Nostalgic Weekend.
Don't touch that dial, because there's nothing else on. You might just as well listen to Blondie. Blondie, rebroadcast for the servicemen and women of the United Nations, with Penny Singleton and Arthur Lake as Blondie and Dagwood Bumstead, respectively.
And now for our weekly visit with our neighbors, the Bumsteads of Shady Lane Avenue, who have as their guest tonight Fanny Bryce as Baby Snook. Yes, tonight, Baby Snooks is going to visit the Bumstead. But first, let's look in at 127 Shady Lane Avenue and see what's going on. Something seems to be wrong with Alexander, the pride and joy of the Bumstead family. It seems he isn't enjoying school this year as much as he did before. Blondie and Dagwood are talking to Alexander, who's just arrived home after a hard day with his teacher.
Well, Alexander, how did school go today? Huh? I said, how did school go today?
I didn't notice.
Hey, what's the matter with you? What happened today?
I don't know. I haven't seen the evening paper yet.
Oh.
We mean, what happened at school?
Oh, at school.
Yeah.
Oh, Alexander, please pay attention and focus your eyes.
Excuse me, Mom.
Seems like you're only half here.
It's even less than that.
Look, Alexander, we'd like to know what happened at school. We're your parents, and we hope we're not asking too much. But we would like to know what happened at school, if anything.
Oh, it was the same old stuff.
Go ahead. What?
Well, the teacher asked me some questions, and I answered the questions.
You answered them all? That's my son.
I answered them all wrong.
That's your son.
Alexander, just what seems to be wrong with school this year, huh?
Nothing. There just doesn't seem to be anything right about it.
And that's a hard situation to correct.
Well, I'm going upstairs and mope around. Call me when dinner's ready.
How do you like that?
I don't. I can't understand what's wrong with him.
Well, Blondie, maybe it's one of those things. You know, Blondie, ever so often he decides on his life's work. And he's going to be an actor, a chemist, or a steeplejack, and we have trouble with him until he forgets it.
What do you think he's decided to be this time?
A loafer.
Well, he can't get away with that in this family, even if he did get the idea from you.
Yeah, even if he did get it, Blondie.
Well, Alexander usually sees you lying on that couch.
Yeah?
He hardly knows what you look like standing up.
Oh, Blondie.
He's beginning to think his father is something horizontal that snores.
Now, Blondie, that's not fair. You can't blame me for the way Alexander's been acting.
Well, what do you think is wrong, then? He certainly lost interest in things.
Yeah, he seems to have lost interest in everything. Yeah, well, wait a minute. I'll test him out. Alexander!
Yeah, Pop?
Do you want a quarter? I said, do you want a quarter?
I heard you the first time, Pop. I'm just thinking it over.
He's lost interest, all right. Well, do you want it?
Yeah, I'll take it.
Oh, thank you too much.
When I come downstairs again, you can drop it in my pocket.
Maybe he'd like me to spend it for him, too.
Dagwood. You know, I've been thinking.
Yeah?
Maybe we're not taking enough interest in his mental development.
Well, I have. I've always been interested in training his mind the same way mine was trained, but you always chase me away from him.
Well, dear, one Dagwood Bumstead is enough.
Yeah.
You know, Dagwood, I think I'd better have a little talk with him and see if I can't get him interested in something.
Oh, that's swell. Yeah, but what are you going to get him interested in?
I know. I know exactly what I'll talk to him about. I'll explain to him what's going on in the world. You know, Alexander doesn't realize that history is being made all around him. Now, Alexander, I want to have a little chat with you.
Okay, Mom. What about?
Well, you seem to have lost interest in things. I don't believe you know what a very important period the world is going through right now.
Oh, yes, but of course I didn't attend the big powwow at Dumbarton Oaks.
Where? Oh, yes. Now, son, you just ask any questions at all, and I'll answer them for you.
What are your opinions on post-war planning and the peace?
Post-war planning and the peace?
Yeah, that's right. Post-war planning and the peace.
Oh.
Yes?
Oh, of course, that question isn't very specific, Alexander. Ask me something that isn't so general.
Well, what do you think of Lord Vansittart's proposals?
Who?
Lord Vansittart.
Oh. Oh, yes, of course.
Well, I guess that's that.
Alexander, where did you hear about this Lord Watchmadoodle?
Oh, I listen to the radio and read the newspapers. You see, Mom, Lord Vansittart is a believer in a hard-boiled peace. He thinks Germany should be occupied for maybe as long as 50 years.
Is that right?
Of course, you know about the Wells plan, don't you?
Well,
Why, Mom.
Now, don't cluck your tongue at me. At least I know the plan was recently worked out by Orson Welles.
No, Mom. It was worked out by Sumner Welles.
Oh, dear. Well, I don't care. You never can tell what Orson Welles is up to either.
You see, Mom, Sumner Welles thinks we ought to divide Germany up into three separate nations, set up a world council, and put dependent areas under the protection of an international trusteeship.
That's simply amazing. Do you know about the Polish problem, too?
Well, I can tell you what the problem is, but I don't know how they're going to unravel it.
Well, now, maybe between the two of us, we can fix that up, too. I'd like to hear, Alexander.
Just make yourself comfortable. Well, it sort of started with the first partition of Poland in 1712.
Imagine that. Well, I didn't know they had partitions in those days. I thought everybody lived in tents. Hello, Dagwood.
Oh, my gosh, Blondie, you certainly were in Alexander's room long enough. Hey, look, did you get him interested in something? Did you explain to him what was going on in the world?
Dagwood, you just wouldn't believe what's happening in the world.
Yeah? Well, what's happening, huh?
Well, I just had a long lecture on international affairs. You know, our son listens like mad to the radio commentators. In fact, he could be one himself. Sort of a Raymond Graham swinglet.
Well, didn't you teach him anything?
No, but I learned a lot myself.
Well, did you snap him out of it, huh?
No, dear. There's something else wrong with him, Dagwood, and I don't know what it is. Alexander seems to be bored with life.
He does? Isn't he a little young for that? I thought they didn't get bored with life until they were 16.
They don't. So I guess he isn't bored with life. Must be something else.
Yeah, well, I know what I'm going to do, Blondie. I'll get him interested in sports. Tomorrow morning, before I leave for the office, I'll take Alexander outside and run him through a little football practice. Yeah, maybe that'll break this up.
We'll see.
Yeah.
But maybe it'll break you up, too. I guess their little football game has gone all right so far this morning. Uh-oh. I spoke too soon. Well, now, let's see. I guess there are plenty of ice cubes for his head, if it is his head, and plenty of cushions if it isn't. Oh, Mom, what happened, Alexander?
Pop tried to go through my side of the line, and I glommed him.
Oh, Alexander.
Well, he needled me into it. I usually pretend I can't hold on to him, but he insisted on my giving him the full treatment.
And you did.
And how? Gee, I'm not in the mood for all this excitement. Well, I've got to be on my way to school, I suppose. So long, Mom.
Oh, wait a minute. Where's your father now?
Ken Niles is bringing him right in.
Now, just take it easy there, Dagwood. Yes, you just lean on me.
Yeah. I'll call the army camp up. I'll have that man court-martialed. They can't do that to Dagwood Bumstead.
Who can't do what?
I've just been sideswiped by a tank destroyer.
Now, Dagwood.
Do I look like a tank?
Well, I wouldn't have married you if you were.
Yeah, well, I can't understand how it happened. I was whizzing past Alexander with the ball when this tank destroyer butted in.
Now, you didn't actually see it, did you, Dagwood?
No, but you saw where it plowed that furrow in the ground, didn't you?
Your nose did that.
Oh, dear, just look at the mud on your shirt. I'll get you a clean one, dear.
The Bumsteads, as if you didn't know, will be back again in just a few moments.
Are you feeling better now, Dagwood?
Yeah, I suppose so, but I still haven't found out what's eating Alexander.
Oh, Dagwood, look at the time. You're going to be late for the office.
Huh? Oh, I do. Oh, holy smoke. Get the door open for me.
It already is open, Dagwood.
It is? Well, then close it and open it again. Do you want to ruin my timing?
All right, Dagwood. The door's open now, Dagwood.
Okay, honey.
Get out of the way, Mr. Niles. He sails out the door like a buzz bomb.
Okay.
Come on, Dagwood. You'll be late to the office. Hurry.
Okay. Where's my hat?
Right there on the hat rack.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Here it is.
Oh, that's not the hat rack. That's Ken Niles.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Goodbye, dear.
Yeah. Goodbye.
Mousehead.
Wow.
Come into my office. Why not?
I've got a white voice and elephant. Ha, ha, ha.
All right, come in as soon as you're through. Bumstead!
I was just making up little jokes, Mr. Ditters.
What's the matter with you? What were you doing?
Well, I was thinking.
On company time, huh? I'll bet it hurt, too.
Mr. Ditters, I've got something on my mind.
I know, it's all over your shoulders, too.
Yeah.
However, what is it?
It's about Alexander. Uh-huh. Ever since school started, he's been moping around and paying very little attention to practically nothing most of the time, usually.
You ought to be hit over the head with that sentence. What's wrong with him?
That's just it, Mr. Ditters. We don't know.
Well, didn't you ever feel like that when you were Alexander's age?
Yeah, I did once. Gosh, I felt terrible. It was like the end of the world.
What happened?
The price of lollipops went up.
How typical.
Yeah.
I don't suppose you know whether the price of lollipops has gone up or down lately.
Oh, the price has stayed the same, but I find they don't last as long.
Oh, I don't know. Anyhow, Alexander's a little more mature than you were at his age.
Huh?
Than you are now, for that matter.
Yeah. J.C., how about it when you went to school? Did anything ever make you feel awful, huh?
Oh, yes, yes, of course.
Oh, it did? Hey, maybe that'll be a clue. What was it?
Well, there was a cute little brunette in school.
Yeah, I should have known. I'll bet you were a regular wolf, junior grade. Hey, go on. What about the little brunette, huh?
Oh, she was 8 and I was 9.
Ah,
what a delicious dish of dimpled divinity.
Oh, now, you couldn't have been that cute, Mr. Divin.
I met the girl.
Oh, yeah.
Her name was Gwendolyn O'Toole. She couldn't play jacks or pachisi, but boy, how she could play post office.
Yeah. Nothing but special delivery airmail letters, huh?
Registered, too.
Yeah, but of course, when you went to school, Mr. Ditters, it was just the Pony Express. Well, go on.
Well, Gwendolyn and I were finally separated. Oh, brother, it was a sad day.
Did her family move out of town?
Oh, no. She went on to 5B and I went back to fourth grade. I had to sweat out an old geography rap.
Yeah.
I certainly lost interest in life.
Hey, wait a minute. I'll bet that's it. There's a woman behind this, Mr. Ditters. And as the French say, Schutzi la Femi.
Oh, yeah, chase the dame.
Maybe you've got something
there.
Yeah,
well, come on. I tell you what we'll do. We'll sort of quiz him and find out. Because if it's a girl that's bothering him, we could... What's the matter? Oh, yeah. Hello, Alexander.
Hello, parents. How's everything at school, Alexander?
Oh, come see, come saw. Just so-so.
Alexander, are there any specially nice girls this year?
Gosh, no. School has been awful since Toots Murphy left. Gosh, what a woman. He certainly could play third base.
What's wrong with the little Rogers girl?
Oh, she always gets weak from undernourishment, right in front of the sweet shop. She gets treated so much, we call her the girl with the golden stomach.
Well, what did this Toots Murphy do?
He used the matches to see who paid.
Oh, yeah.
Gosh, I certainly miss that gal. Well, that's life. Well, I guess I'll go out and back and burn some leaves.
Thank you, Alexander.
Yeah, I guess that's it, all right.
Oh, Dagwood, I know just the thing to cure him.
Well, what is it?
Well, a very sweet little girl moved into our neighborhood a few weeks ago. I think I'll invite her over to meet Alexander.
A sweet little girl? Who is it?
I think her family name is Higgins, but everyone calls her Snooks.
You mean Baby Snooks on the radio?
Yes, dears.
Oh, boy, Blondie, anything can happen now.
Dagwood, that's probably Baby Snooks.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I see her at the door. She certainly is a sweet-looking little girl, isn't she?
Dagwood, you let her in. Oh, dear, I hope she gets along with Alexander. How?
Do the Bumsteads live here?
Oh, yes. Sure. Here, won't you come right in, Snooks?
Are you Mrs. Bumstead?
Me? Hey, Blondie, did you hear that?
What does she mean?
What do you mean, Snooks?
My daddy says that Mrs. Bumstead wears a pants in this family.
He must have seen me wearing slacks.
Yeah, that must be it. Well, come inside, Snooks.
Why? Because there's a very nice little boy we want you to meet.
I don't like nice little boys.
Well, what do you like?
I like to throw eggs in electric fans.
Well, Snooks, we have electric fans somewhere.
Yeah,
I was... I was only trying to be helpful.
Well, if you want to be helpful, stay here and entertain Snooks. Yeah. I'll be back as soon as I can find Alexander.
Yeah, okay. Well, Snooks, won't you come inside and close the door?
Why?
Because it's cold outside.
If I close the door, will it make it any warmer outside?
Well, I don't know. I never thought of that. There. Here we are. Now, is there anything you want?
Yeah.
What?
I want to go home.
But you just got here. Would you like a nice piece of cake?
Chocolate layer cake?
Yes.
A chocolate filling?
Yes.
And chocolate all over the top?
Yes.
I don't like chocolate.
Maybe you'd like to play a game, huh?
No.
Will you play a game with me if I give you a penny?
Uh-huh.
Oh, all right. Here's a penny.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, that's nice. I like to hear little girls say thank you.
Give me another penny and you'll hear it again.
Well, no. Let's start the game. Now we'll start the game. You go first.
All right. Adam and Eve... and Pinch Me were on a raft. Adam and Eve fell off. Who was left?
Pinch Me.
Okay.
Oh, hey, that hurt. Yeah, what kind of a game is that, huh? A game is something you're supposed to enjoy.
Well, I enjoyed it.
Yeah, well, it's my turn now, Snooks. Adam and Eve and Pinch Me were on a raft.
Adam and Eve and who?
Pinch Me.
Okay.
He did it again.
You want to play another game?
Yeah, well, sure, if it's different. What's this one called, huh?
Adam and Eve and Sock Me were on a raft.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, no, you don't. Get away from me.
Her hand, that woman, sir.
I never touched her.
Snooks, may I present my son, Alexander Bumstead?
He's funny looking.
Oh, brother.
Now, I want you two children to like each other.
Well, I like her.
Well, what do you say, Snooks?
You want to fight?
Now, Snooks, don't you know that little girls shouldn't fight?
Uh-huh.
And aren't you ashamed of yourself?
Uh-huh.
Then what do you say to Alexander?
Want to wrestle?
Oh, Snooks, I'm so disappointed. I thought you...
Oh, leave her alone, Mom. I like a girl with spunk. Now, come on, Snooks. Let's go out and play.
All right, funny face.
I love that girl. Don't you think Snooks is wonderful, Mom?
I certainly do, Alexander.
What do you think, Pop?
I check.
Well, so long, folks. Snooks and I are going out. What would you like to play, Snooks?
I got a swell new game.
What's it called?
Adam and Eve and Pinch Me Wanna Rest.
Well, Dagwood, I don't think Alexander's going to be bored with life anymore.
No, I'll say not, Blondie. You sure cured him, all right.
Yeah!
This is the Armed Forces Radio Service.
Stay right where you are. There's more action coming away straight ahead on One Nostalgic Weekend. But first, this message.
Want a brand new breakfast idea? Then get the Betty Crocker cereal tray, the Betty Crocker cereal tray. Yes, indeed. Try the brand new cereal assortment with 10 individual packages in all. 4 Wheaties, 4 Cheerios, 2 Kix. All top favorites and all extra fresh. Yes, it's fun to take your pick from Wheaties, Cheerios, and Kix. Get the Betty Crocker cereal tray, the Betty Crocker cereal tray. Get that tray today.
Life is swell when you keep well. That's why Post 40% Bran Flakes have become America's largest selling Bran Flakes. Every 1 ounce serving of Post 40% Bran Flakes provides bran to help prevent irregularity due to lack of bulk in the diet. They're so delicious tasting and so good for you, too. Tomorrow, serve America's favorite Bran Flakes. Post 40% Bran Flakes.
This is Mr. Perry White's house, and inside, Perry White of the Daily Planet is just sitting down to breakfast. Mr. White is one of those remarkable men who is in complete control of himself in any crisis. Calm, cool-headed, easygoing, even-tempered.
Where are those Kellogg's cornflakes? If someone doesn't bring me another package within 2 seconds, I'll...
2 seconds? This sounds like a job for Superman.
About time.
Mr. White's a man who always gets his way. But even Superman couldn't keep everybody in Kellogg's cornflakes all the time. Every morning, more people run out of Kellogg's cornflakes than any other cereal. They taste best to more people. Always have, still do. That's why it's so easy to run out of them. So anytime you buy any cereal of any kind, pick up a spare package of Kellogg's cornflakes. You'll like them.
Stay tuned for the second half of One Nostalgic Weekend right after these messages.
As an 18-year-old, I let my mistakes kind of take over my life. I was 0.5 credits away from completing high school, and I didn't do it.
10 years later, at age 28, Jackie finished her high school diploma.
When I found out that I was pregnant, I know that I had to do something for myself if I wanted to make her a better person and provide a better life for her. My family never stopped pushing for me to be better because they knew what I could become and who I could become as a person. My support team is amazing. The educational director, my sister, and even my 7-year-old daughter has just been more than the support that I could ask for. I've been given an opportunity, and I'm just thankful for it.
No one gets a diploma alone. If you're thinking of finishing your high school diploma, you have help. Find free adult education classes near you at finishyourdiploma.org. That's finishyourdiploma.org. Brought to you by the Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Ad Council.
Adopt US Kids presents What to Expect When You're Expecting a Teenager. Learning the lingo.
Today I'm going to help parents translate teen slang. Now, when a teen says something is on fleek, it's exactly like saying, that's rad. It simply means that something is awesome or cool. Another one is totes. It's exactly like saying totally, just shorter. As in, I totes love going to the mall with Becca. Another word you might hear is jelly. Jelly is a shorter, better way to say jealous. As in, Chloe, I am like so jelly of your unicorn phone case.
You don't have to speak teen to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will think you're, rad, just the same. To learn more, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, AdoptUSKids, and the Ad Council.
Excuse me, I know you have a 9 o'clock, so I'll keep this short. I'm the business suit in the back of your closet. You wore me nearly every day before your office went, quote, casual. I used to be the CEO of your closet. Now I'm just that one intern no one ever talks to. I always thought you'd circle back with me, get granular, keep me in the pipeline. But nada, nothing. Don't you remember the McKittrick presentation? You spilled coffee on me and I still looked amazing during the breakout talkback Q&A. So, I think it's time for me to move on. I've got a great resume and I absolutely crush it in interviews, okay? Let's make this a clean break. Shift the paradigm. The only thing I ask is that you think outside the box here and do this. Take me to Goodwill, where I can really make a difference.
Your donations to Goodwill create new jobs, training programs, and education assistance for people in your community. To find your nearest donation center, go to goodwill.org. Donate stuff. Create jobs. A message from Goodwill and the Ad Council.
Hello. It's me, the designer jeans in your closet. The back of your closet. What am I doing here? Would you keep caviar in the back of your fridge with the ketchup and old milk? Yeah, I don't think so. So, what happened to us? I mean, have you seen my label? I used to summer in the Hamptons, and now I'm stuck behind a pair of sweats. Sure, I never really fit you quite right, and one of my pockets is so small you can't even squeeze your hand into it. But it's all about the look. And I look good. I need to get back out on the scene so I can be seen. You know, going to fancy parties, getting expensive iced coffees, Sunday fun days, okay? So take me to Goodwill, where I can really make a difference.
Your donations to Goodwill create new jobs, training programs, and education assistance for people in your community. To find your nearest donation center, go to goodwill.org. Donate stuff. Create jobs. A message from Goodwill and the Ad Council.
A message to help keep you safe. If doctors told us today that we'd made a breakthrough on COVID-19, saving thousands of lives, we would rejoice. Finally, a good news day. We'd feel less afraid that our loved ones would be struck by the invisible enemy. We'd start to feel hope that we could live our lives again. Well, a mask does all that. We can help protect others by covering our noses and mouths, which is how the virus mainly spreads. Masks are a ticket to freedom, to be out in the world, to getting together, back to work, back to doing what we want. If doctors announced we could save lives today, we would grab that breakthrough with both hands. While we wait for a vaccine, grab the breakthrough that's already here. When we're out, it's masks on.
Brought to you by the Ad Council.
And now, part two of One Nostalgic Weekend.
The story you are about to hear is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Dragnet on both radio and television.
You're a detective sergeant. You're assigned a juvenile detail. An 8-month-old baby is stolen from its mother. It's the third case of child stealing reported in less than 3 weeks. There's no lead on the suspect. Your job? Get him.
Dragnet, the documented drama of an actual crime. For the next 30 minutes, in cooperation with the Los Angeles Police Department, you will travel step by step on the side of the law through an actual case transcribed from official police files. From beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
It was Wednesday, June 18th. It was warm in Los Angeles. We were working the day watch out of juvenile division. My partner's Frank Smith. The boss is Captain Stein. My name's Friday. It was 6:30 p.m. when we got back to 1335 Georgia Street, second floor, the squad room.
Hi, I've been waiting for you.
Hi, Captain.
How's it going? Any sign of the baby?
No, not yet. We're doing everything we can. We haven't got a lead to our name.
Lousy thing. How's it stack up? Anything like the last two cases?
Yeah, quite a bit. Same neighborhood, same general M.O.
We checked with just about everybody in the vicinity. No one saw the baby taken.
Happened about 10 o'clock this morning?
10:15. Mrs. Donaldson drove down to the neighborhood shopping center to do her marketing. She had the baby in a bassinet in the back seat of her car. Baby boy, 8 months old.
Mm-hmm.
She pulled into the parking lot right behind the market, left the baby asleep in the car. She went in to do her shopping. When she came out, the baby was gone.
How long was she in the market?
She told us about 20 minutes.
We talked to a half a dozen people who drove their cars in and out of the parking lot about that time. They couldn't help me. They didn't see anyone loitering around.
How about delivery trucks? They usually unload supplies at the back door, don't they?
Already checked on that. We talked to the driver of a bread truck. He was making a delivery about that time. He couldn't help us either. The mother, Mrs. Donaldson, she's the only one who came up with anything at all. It's not much, but it's better than nothing.
Yeah.
Well, when she parked her car and got out to go in the market, she noticed a woman sitting in the car parked next to hers. When she came back and found her baby was gone, she noticed that this woman's car was gone, too.
Mrs. Donaldson described the woman for you?
Yeah, she was middle-aged. She had gray hair. That's all she remembered.
How about the car the woman was in?
It was a green sedan. That's the only thing Mrs. Donaldson could tell us. She's not even sure of that.
And there's no one else around the market that remembered the car, huh?
Well, if there is, we haven't found him.
We covered the whole neighborhood, Skipper. Talked to everybody we could. Got us nowhere. Smoke out.
Oh, thanks.
You, Joe?
Yeah, thank you. I got a light.
Okay.
Captain?
No kickback yet on the broadcast. The old points you got out on the baby?
No, nothing. Up to now, it's a carbon copy of the last two job. No suspect, no motive.
Mrs. Donaldson can't think of any reason at all for it.
No, not a one. Her husband's a teamster. They don't have much money. She couldn't think of any friend or relative who might possibly want to take their baby.
The baby normal and good health?
Yeah, perfect.
It's got me. This makes it about one a week.
Just about. Martin baby was taken on the 5th. The Andrews baby was taken on the 12th. Both of them recovered in 24 hours. Nothing wrong with either of them. Sure doesn't make sense.
Must be a psycho case of some kind. I think we can go along on that.
Now, this one happened near 8th and Dinehart, that right?
Yeah, same neighborhood as the other two. About a 12-square block area there.
How about that lead you had on the old man out there? Did you exhaust that?
Yeah, the old gardener?
Mm-hmm.
We double-checked him this afternoon. He wasn't anywhere near the market when the Donaldson baby was taken.
How about the other two people you had your eye on? Either of them anywhere near the scene at the time?
Neither one of them, Skipper. Both clear.
How's it stand now?
Well, we're doing everything possible. Dean Bergman went over the Donaldson car for prints. The bassinet, too. There's no word from him yet. Special detail from Metro Division still going over the neighborhood. Nothing from them either.
No sign of any physical evidence, huh? I mean, besides any possible prints.
No, nothing, Captain. The usual number of tips from people in the neighborhood. Checked on all of them. They went nowhere.
Well, we've just about run the gamut on this thing. You have anything in mind?
Well, Joe and I were kicking around an idea on the way back in. Figure it might be worth a try. I mean, providing we get the Donaldson case cleared.
Yeah?
Joe?
Well, for one thing, we figure the neighborhood out there works in our favor. All three of the babies were taken in the same 12-square block area. It's the strongest part of the M.O. that we got to work on. Now, if we get good enough coverage in that area out there, it might lead somewhere.
What maybe. Kind of coverage?
Well, maybe a system of decoys, something to draw the suspect out at the right time, the right place.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. What have you got in mind?
Well, Frank and I were figuring if we could round up half a dozen policewomen or so, let them work different points around the neighborhood and make it obvious that they're housewives.
Yeah.
Have each one of them with a baby carriage. Spot them at the shopping centers out there in that area. They leave the carriages outside the stores, go through the motions of doing their shopping, and cover each one of them.
Mm-hmm. What do you do for bait?
I think we can fake it, Skipper. Put a life-size doll in each of the carriages, keep it pretty well covered. Fair chance it'll get us a nibble if we work it right.
About half a dozen policewomen, that's what you figure?
Yeah, I figure that ought to do it.
Mm-hmm. Excuse me.
Yeah.
Juvenile Division, Captain Stein. Yeah, that's right. Uh-huh. How's that? I see. Mrs. Bolger. Yes, ma'am, I understand. How's that? Yes, ma'am, if you like. All right, thank you. Goodbye. Queer one.
Yeah?
Either one of you contacted Mrs. Marion Bolger the last month or so?
No, it's not familiar to me. How about you, Frank?
Don't recall the name. Why?
Bolger.
That was her on the phone. She wants to be investigated. Says she wants to prove to us that she's not involved in any of these child-stealing cases.
How do you spell that name?
Marion Bolger, B-O-L-G-E-R, Ewing Street address.
No, I never heard of her. What's the pitch?
Got me. She kept saying she's got to have her name cleared. She's innocent. Kept insisting she didn't steal the Donaldson baby.
Well, we didn't say she did. We don't even know the woman.
You're going to. Check her out.
We ran the name Marion Bolger through R&I, but there was no previous criminal record on her. 7:25 p.m. Frank Smith and I left the office and drove out to the Ewing Street address to interview the Bolger woman. Before we called at her home, we checked with some of the neighbors. Most of them had a favorable opinion of her. They described her as a pleasant woman, slightly eccentric. The only complaint was that the Bolger woman was very fond of children and that she kept most of the youngsters on the block well supplied with cake and candy, despite repeated objections from the youngsters' parents. Other than that, they seemed to like her. 8:05 p.m., Frank and I called on Mrs. Bolger and she ushered us into a neatly furnished living room. She was an older woman, possibly in her early 60s, dark brown hair streaked with gray.
It's the honest truth, Sergeant. Anybody who really knows me would tell you I wouldn't do a thing like that. I love children. I want all of them to be happy. I wouldn't steal anybody's baby.
Just a minute, Mrs. Bolger, please. Something we'd like to get straight.
I don't care how it looks. I don't care what they say. I didn't do it. I didn't steal those other two babies. I didn't steal the Donaldson baby either.
How'd you know the Donaldson baby was missing, ma'am? It just happened this morning.
The evening paper. The whole story's in there. It's the first I knew about it, so help me, when I got my evening paper. Please, Sergeant, you got to believe me.
All right, now, try to take it easy, ma'am. What gives you the idea that we're accusing you of taking those babies?
Well, you haven't yet. Not in so many words. You're thinking about it, though. I know that. You've been told.
How do you mean, told what?
You know what I mean. All those stories going around about me. just because I like children, because I enjoy them. I understand them. Just because of that, they try to make me out a witch or something, trying to say I took those poor little babies.
All right, just a minute, ma'am. Who said you took the babies?
Down at the store this afternoon. I heard them. That grocery clerk and that silly Mrs. Murdoch. They laughed about it. Tried to make out there's only fooling. Well, I knew better. They weren't fooling. They meant it. Accusing me of such a terrible thing. I just don't know when I've been so upset.
Well, now, what grounds would they have for saying anything like that, ma'am? I mean, even if they were fooling.
Only because I love children, that's all. People in the neighborhood are the same way. They don't like me. They go around saying things about me. Just because I understand their children better than they do. Just because I know how to treat children.
No, I think you got it wrong, Mrs. Bulger. The only complaint your neighbors have is that you treat children too well. A little too much candy, huh?
Well, nothing wrong with giving a child candy. Good homemade fudge. I make it myself. Besides, how would you know about that?
We talked to your neighbors, ma'am. They had a lot of nice things to say about you.
Yes, I just bet they did. Nasty, dirty stories. They've been passing them all over the neighborhood about me.
No, ma'am, you've got it wrong.
Just let me show you. Come in here, this way, the dining room.
Yes, ma'am.
Look at that. Look at that.
Yes, ma'am, it's very nice.
You see how I decorated the table? Paper streamers all over the room. It is supposed to be a party for the children in the neighborhood. I worked a whole week getting it ready. I made the cakes myself, decorated them too. I made everything in my own kitchen. Candy, sandwiches. Took me a whole week. And they didn't even come. They didn't come.
Ma'am?
The neighborhood children. It was supposed to be for them. Special summer party I wanted to give them today. They didn't even come. The parents wouldn't let them. Not one of them. It's a crime. Terrible crime. All this good food.
Well, now, maybe there was a mistake, ma'am.
There wasn't any mistake. I invited the children, 14 of them. Mothers wouldn't let them come. I had everything ready. Little favors for each one of them. Now, look. Ice cream's all melted. Hot cocoa boiled away to nothing.
Yes, ma'am.
Even the paper streamers are coming down. Such a mean thing to do. Keeping children from a party. Such a mean thing.
Well, we don't like to bother you, Mrs. Bulger. Just like to ask you a few routine questions, then we'll let you alone.
Anything you want to know, Sergeant?
Can you account for your time this morning, ma'am, between 9 a.m. and 11 a.m.?
Yes, of course I can. I was right here in the house getting things ready for the party. My friend Aggie Benson was with me. She's a school chum of mine. She was helping me get things ready.
Well, then you didn't leave the house at any time this morning, did you?
No, sir, I didn't. You can ask Aggie. She'll tell you.
Do you have a car, Mrs. Bulger?
Oh, my, no. I wouldn't know what to do with it if I had one. I never learned to drive. Why'd you want to know?
Just routine, ma'am. Well, I guess we'd better be going, Frank.
All right, sir.
And you don't believe those stories, do you? I mean, just because I like children, I'd steal those babies. You don't believe that, do you?
No, ma'am. We haven't any reason to believe it.
I knew you'd understand. I wouldn't do a thing like that. I just love children, Sergeant. Never had any of my own. Living here by myself. No husband. Lonely. Terrible thing, being lonely.
Yes, ma'am, yes.
There's only one answer for it. Children. Big family. It's an old saying. It's very true.
Ma'am.
When you get to be 63, you want something else to wake up to beside the morning paper.
8:40 p.m. Before we headed back for the office, Frank and I made a thorough check on Mrs. Bulger, her background and her alibi. We found nothing to link her in any way with the child stealings. 9:15 p.m., we got back to the city hall and went directly to Leighton Fingerprints, where we met with Dean Bergman. He'd found several sets of prints on the Donaldsons' car and on the bassinet from which their baby had been stolen. Most of them were those of the parents, Mr. and Mrs. Donaldson. Bergman was unable to identify the two foreign prints found inside the car. We contacted the officers in charge of the special detail checking the neighborhood where the latest child stealing had occurred. They'd failed to uncover a lead. 7:48 a.m. the following morning.
Friday?
Morning, Captain.
Good piece of news. The Donaldson baby, they just found him.
Where?
Highland Park area. They found him in a cardboard box. Apparently he's all right. A little exposure. Doctors are checking him over now at Georgia Street.
How about the suspect? Any sign of him?
Not a trace.
It was little or no different than the first two cases. Some 21 hours after he'd been abducted from the car in the parking lot at the rear of the market near 8th and Dinehart, the Donaldson baby had been recovered apparently unharmed. The cardboard box in which the baby had been found was gone over for fingerprints. Routine investigation at the scene and in the neighborhood where the child had been found failed to turn up a lead on the abductor. Frank and I checked with Dr. George Hall, who'd examined the child. After that, we talked with Mr. and Mrs. Donaldson. The details of the case coincided almost point for point with the first two abductions. The baby had been taken, then recovered in a 24-hour period. Outside a slight exposure, the child was unharmed. Also, like the two cases preceding it, something which the child was wearing at the time of his abduction was missing. In the first case, it was a small pink sweater. In the second, a pair of shoes the baby was wearing. In the case of the Donaldson baby, it was a sterling silver ID bracelet with the initials JD engraved on it. During the next 5 days, Frank and I ran down every lead we could get our hands on. They went nowhere. Our system of policewomen decoys was put in effect. It failed to get a rise. On the sixth day, Thursday, June 26th, 5:30 p.m., we got word of another child stealing, this time in the Echo Park area. We drove out to talk to the mother, a Mrs. Chester Osborne.
Yeah, that's right. I did the same thing I do every morning. Gave the baby her bath, dressed her, put her out in the backyard in her buggy. She usually plays a while, then she takes her nap.
And about what time did you discover your baby was missing?
I don't know exactly. About 2 o'clock, I guess. Maybe a couple of minutes after. Went out to see how she was, looked in the buggy, and she was gone.
Well, it's almost 6 o'clock now, Mrs. Osborne. How is it that you waited so long before you notified us?
Just kept hoping it was a mistake, that's all. I went from house to house all over the neighborhood. Went as far as 3 blocks away. I asked everybody. Nobody saw my baby. You don't know what it means to me.
The telephone, Mrs. Osborne.
Would you answer it, please? Whoever it is, take the number. I'll call him back.
Yes, ma'am. Be glad to. Hello. Yeah. Yes, sir. Oh, yeah, Harry, we're here now. This is Friday. How's that? When? I see. Where? That's all. Okay, Harry, thanks. Yeah, tell him we'll be right in. Right away. Okay, bye. Well, that was our office, Mrs. Osborne. You can stop worrying now.
What?
It was about your little girl. She's all right.
What do you mean?
Well, I just found her 3 blocks from here.
Again, with the lone exception of the time element, the Osborne baby's abduction resembled closely the 3 previous cases. The crime occurred in the same general area. The same general method of operation was employed. And again, outside of slight exposure, the child was recovered unharmed. There was also an article of clothing missing, a pink knitted bonnet. And as in the previous 3 cases, the suspect had abandoned the baby without detection. Routine investigation by the crime laboratory crew and juvenile officers working the case failed to turn up a lead. During the week that followed, additional personnel for both decoys and stakeouts were assigned to the area without results. Friday, July 4th, 10 a.m.
Joe, you busy?
What do you got, Frank?
Galvin and Mildred Leslie just called in on this child stealing thing. Looks like it might be something.
Yeah, what's the pitch?
Well, this Leslie girl's employed as a maid for a Mr. and Mrs. Roth, R-O-T-H.
Mm-hmm.
She's a stockbroker. She's worked for him a year or so, she says.
Yeah.
The Leslie girl's an upstairs maid for the Roths. She's been following this baby stealing case in the papers right along. She thinks maybe Mrs. Roth can tell us something about it.
Yeah, how's that?
Well, the Leslie girl was cleaning Mrs. Roth's bedroom yesterday. She came across a few things.